pastures, and he guides me along the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me on the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for he is with me. His rod and his staff, it comforts me. He even prepares a table in the presence of my enemies. He anoints my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. As Jesus walks along the still waters to go call his first disciples, I ask myself the question, how long had he been watching these men before he went and asked them to follow him? We have the framework of this story of Jesus just appearing on the Sea of Galilee and walking and asking his disciples to follow him and them dropping their nets and him saying, I will make you fishers of men. And that's a great story of immediate obedience in the midst of uncertainty. But I ask myself the question, what events led up to this calling? I see Jesus on the hillside of Galilee in this valley looking over this lake early in the morning before anybody else had woken up, which he often did. And praying to the Father, seeking the will of the Father, trying to harmonize himself and his calling to the Father. And as he sits there and the sun begins to crest over the hills and breaking through the fog of the sun rays, and he's smelling the vegetation and the wind is blowing, I see him looking out on the lake at these men in this boat and saying to the Father, are you sure it's these men? Are you sure these are the young men who were going to plant this church, who were going to build this kingdom? These are the guys. I've been listening to them. Their sounds echo off the water. Are you sure it's these guys? And in his alone time with God, one-on-one, in that moment, God says to him, yes, they are them. Now go and call them. And Jesus, with all the peace, walks on the still waters of the Galilee, and he calls his first disciples. When it comes to calling, I think all of us have this longing to know what our specific one is. It's innate in us. We were created to be this way. We all have this strive of greatness inside of us. And those of us who don't, they've had it at one point, but it's been quenched or put out along the way by somebody or some external circumstance. But for the most part, we are all infatuated with our sense of calling. And wouldn't it be nice if Jesus would just bust into our office and say, turn the computer off. Put the phone down. You are now a financial planner of men. And us saying, okay, but it's not the same thing because the disciples didn't know who Jesus was. We get to live on this side of the divine twist. Well, they thought that a lion was going to come conquer and set up an earthly kingdom. God had this perfect plan of sending a sacrificial lamb to come in and set up his eternal kingdom. So even then, the disciples were not as sure as you think they would be with Jesus approaching them. But we all want to know, what is our specific calling? It's a question myself that I get since Ella and I decided to plant this church. People were asking us, how did you know when you were called to plant the church? Everyone wants to know what you're so sure of so that they too may have that secret ingredient of faith and obedience. And if somebody's sure of their calling, they write books and you buy the books and you want to tap into what that is, to that greatness. We all have that drive. Abraham Lincoln, in a state of despair, at one point his friends thought he was going to take his own life, and he said, I cannot take my own life because I haven't yet done anything for history to remember my name. It is in us. And it drives us, and it captivates us. And so when I'm asked the question, how do you know when you were called? How did you know for sure? All I have is my story. And today I want to tell you about the story of us going to plant Kaleo Phoenix in Phoenix, Arizona. I started feeling last year a sense and a stirring in my life, and I didn't know what it was. I just knew that God was doing something for me. And his calling, which kaleo actually is the Greek word for call, which has a very specific reason for us naming this church that. But I was sitting in my sacred place of my garage. Rest in peace. I do not have a garage anymore, and I'm going to miss that very much. But my sacred place in my garage where I would go do my projects. And I don't know why I'm wired this way, but I like to go and just do stuff and build stuff and create stuff in my garage. And this day was a random Saturday, and I was mounting turkeys in my garage. I know, why would you go mount turkeys? Why waste your time doing that? But my dad and I had shot a couple turkeys, and honestly, I just wanted to have the turkeys in my office. I thought it'd be really cool looking. And so instead of paying somebody, I decided I wanted to be the one to mount these turkeys. So I went to the World Wide Web of YouTube and learned how to mount these turkeys. And just a side note, if you don't get anything from today, know that nothing is impossible, nada es imposible with YouTube. So there you go. You can put that in your wheelhouse and be a better person for that. When I was in there and I was messing with these turkeys, I was asking the question that many of you are probably asking right now, why were you mounting turkeys? And in this moment, I was self-reflecting on why I am wired the way that I am, and I was looking back at other projects I had done in my life, and I thought back to one of the only fights my wife and I have ever gotten into, because we have nearly a perfect marriage with Christ at the center. It's incredible. Thank you, Ellen, for being such a good wife. But we got in one of our few fights at the furniture store. How many of you have been in a fight at the furniture store? If you survive a fight at the furniture store, you're going to make it. I'm telling you. But we were walking through and we're looking at these coffee tables and kitchen tables, and I'm telling her, I think I could build that. Let's not spend $2,000 on this. Let me build it. Let me figure this out. And at this moment, I had never built anything in my entire life. And my wife just got her first home, and her husband was going to ruin it with terrible furniture leaning sideways and splinters for the kids. But I said I thought I could do it, and so she graciously let me attempt my first project, and I went out and I jumped all in. For Christmas, I got my tools, and I kept buying tools, and then I started building stuff, and I'd even sell some stuff online, and I got all into it. And there was something to me special about building the things in my home, and I appreciated it more. Yes, there's people who build better things, and there's some restoration hardware. Are you kidding me? I can't build like that, but my sense of appreciation and gratitude and just sentiment for this table that we're sitting around sharing a meal, knowing that I played a part in bringing this about, is special to me. And so I'm thinking to myself, why did God wire me this way? Why am I the guy mounting turkeys in my garage? And then it hit me like an epiphany. And when I say epiphany, I don't take that lightly. What I believe epiphany is an act of the Holy Spirit, bringing something to light that was not currently seen. And God epiphanized in my soul, and he said, you know two things for sure that I created you to do. One of them is to preach the word. You were called to preach the word, to be the best communicator you could ever be, to study preaching the word, and to preach it faithfully in my text. And also, I've created you to build. And at that moment, it hit me. I realized that me preaching the word would never be fully appreciated by myself in the way I was created to be unless I was a part of building that platform in which the word was preached. And there you have it. I felt called, kaleo, to go plant a church. I went inside and I told my wife that I think we were supposed to plant a church, and she looked at me and said, okay, well, let's pray about it. And from that moment on, we began praying and seeking the Lord's guidance in what this looked like. About a year and a half ago, some random guy called me and asked if I'd be interested in planting a church in Phoenix. And at that moment, I had no plans of planting a church anywhere. So I told him, thank you, but no thank you. Well, about 6 months later, after I actually did feel called to plant a church, another guy, not even the same guy, I think the first guy's an angel or something, because I've even tried to get back in touch with him and he's gone. I don't know what's going on with him. But another guy calls me and says, hey, would you consider planting a church out in the valley? It's a place that really needs churches out here in Phoenix. So this place is in need of the gospel. And so I flew out there and I checked it out. God began to work in me a vision to plant a church in a downtown area or urban setting. And I don't know why, but God had drawn me to that culture to reach a specific group of people, young professionals and millennials, because in this nation, no other generation has left the church more than my generation, the millennials, which I call Gen Y because millennial has a negative connotation. Do not put us all in a box, please. But we want to go reach these people who have left the church in the city environment. And God began to work that out. And I did all the second guessing, like, why am I picking Phoenix just right off the bat? Am I rushing this? So I had a couple cities on the board, and I was having lunch with Mark Miller, our missions pastor, and I was like, man, am I being irresponsible just to jump all into Phoenix? And he said, well, does it need churches? I said, yeah, it does. He said, would it slow your progress of planting down if you did other cities because you've had all these open doors and connections you've already made? And I said, yes, it would. And he looked at me and said, why not Phoenix? And at that moment, I had a strong pull towards Phoenix, even stronger than before. My wife and I fly back out there, and we're on the balcony, and we say, all right, we're going to decide right now on the count of three, what is it going to be? Are we doing this? And we said, one, two, three, yes, both of us. And at that moment, the vision of Kaleo had crystallized. For us, I just want to give you a little bit of background about why we're going to Phoenix. Phoenix is the fifth largest city in the country of 1.5 million people. Its county that it's in is 5 million people, and it's one of the fastest growing metropolitan areas in the country behind Dallas and Houston. There's a lot of tech companies moving into the valley because right now in Silicon Valley, there's a state income tax. Arizona does not have that. And so these tech companies are moving in to Arizona, and they're trying to make it the next Silicon Valley. And guess what? It's right in central Phoenix where our house is, where we're trying to plant our church, which we had no idea that that was happening until we found out just recently that they're trying to do this huge boom, the local government, to make it the next tech hub, bringing in tons of new young professionals to come in to the valley. And God keeps showing up about, yes, this is where you're supposed to be. Yes, this is where you're supposed to be. Well, the national average of people who believe in just believe in God, is 48%. That's the Bible Belt, that's New York, that's LA, that's Oregon, Washington, that's all of them together, 48%. Well, Phoenix is 42%, 6%. That's a big percentage of people. 42%, 6% under the national average of people who even believe in God in the first place. Only 12% of the population in Phoenix are what we are today, evangelical Christian. It is a place that desperately needs the gospel. It's a place that needs the church. And we intend to go out and be a part of that solution to bring the gospel. And that's why we are going to Phoenix. And God keeps showing up time and time again. And people are asking, how are you so sure? And for me, basically, I was alone with God when he told me you're called to plant. And each day since, we've taken one step of obedience and he keeps showing up. Another step of obedience and he shows up. And every time I'm alone with God, he keeps reaffirming and confirming and validating and saying, this is what you're called to do. And in the moments of despair where I'm thinking, what am I doing? I don't have a microphone. I don't have a stage. I don't have a congregation. I don't have a tech guy. I don't have anybody who makes us what we are and what I know. God shows up with somebody who has faithfully endorsed what we are doing. God has showed up with a vision and a calling, and he keeps showing me this light, and I have this still water feeling of my soul that is at peace, but it happens when I'm alone with God. And I share that to you today because as we are constantly asking the question, how do you know when you're called? I want to ask you a question. In this very moment, how is your soul? How are you doing? How are you in God? Because before we can figure out our big call, we have to first know God. Because we want to go enact his will, we first have to know the God whose will we are enacting. We have to get alone with God, and we see these big plans, but we neglect this alone time. And I just want to ask you, what does your alone time look like currently? When you're alone, what does it look like? Is it sacred? A quote from Wendell Berry, he said, there's no sacred or unsacred places in this world, just sacred and desecrated places. So where you are, where the Spirit is, when you're alone, what does that look like? Where are you filling that time with? And as Christians, what if we were to sacrifice that possessive word, your alone time, and we substitute it with God's alone time with you? Because then when we get that and we start seeking the will of God and we get on our knees before him and we get to know him intimately the way that Jesus would withdraw and get to know his Father, that is when we have the harmony of who God is and we hear the heartbeat and he begins to reveal himself and we have these epiphanies and we walk step by step and at the end of the day we look back and we have no idea how we got here, but we know that it was God who carried us and we didn't do it on our own. So we have this big plan. We have this big calling, but God's not going to lay out this big calling in your life if you're not faithful in the small things in your life currently. So as Christians, we are called to create space in our life to get one-on-one with God. We are called to create space in our lives to get to know the Father. And so as we're anxious and trying to figure out right now, as we go into the next year, I just want to challenge you and encourage you. What is your alone time going to look like as you set this new year up? I think I can make the broad sweeping statement that most of us can ring true that on the last day of 2017, we're kind of tired, aren't we? We look back over the year and we've been going and going and going. Some of us have experienced loss and some of us have had things happen along the way that are hard. Most of us have not fulfilled our resolutions, which I will say you have about, let me see, you got about 10 to 12 hours to go run your marathon, to read 10 books, and to lose 15 pounds. Go find a sauna, put on a trash bag. Si se puede, you can do it. But we have all these ambitions and expectations for our lives, and we go and we go and we go, and it's the American way, right? Better work means more work. Hard work means more work. And we stress and we stress and we stress and we stress, but that's not the way that God had created us from the very beginning. God took a day off and he gave us rest, and I want to give us permission today that you need rest in your life. Any professional athlete knows this, that stress plus rest equals growth. You cannot continue to work a muscle over and over and over without breaking it down. You have to give it its time to rest so that it can grow even further. So as you stress with the challenges of faithful living, and you have the stress of the things that happened in your life that you didn't foresee, and you have the stress of relationships and job and expectations, you also have the rest of the Lord. And when he says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He guides me along the still waters. He restores my soul." That's pivotal. Because we try to go into the valley armed and equipped, ready to go on this call, but sometimes we neglect this time of laying down. We neglect the time of the peaceful waters that are just gently tied coming in and out. We neglect the restoration of our soul, and we get a bunch of broken down, discouraged, and Christians who are leaving the church because it is too hard. But when we get it, and we follow the way that Jesus showed us to live, we will have this peace inside our souls that will give us the energy that we need. We will have this gentleness of the Spirit that even when we're in the valley of the shadow of death, we can lean in on and we can rest assured upon and we can know. So how did Jesus know that they were called? Well, he got alone with the Father as he sat on the hill with this great appreciation for creation. Because he got to see it be brought about, every tree, every person. He got to feel the grass and know that he had a part in bringing it about. And he sat there, and he just sat there with this sense of gratitude and thanksgiving. There's something about nature that does that in us, right? Something bigger than us, something beautiful, something created, the created order for us to appreciate. And as Jesus created space in his life to get alone, he sat in the nature of what his Father had created, and he had this great sense of appreciation, and he looks over in the sea, and he looks at these men, the prize, the crown jewel of creation, and he looks at them, and you know he's praying for them. This prayer of anticipation, this prayer of obligation. He knows that these men are about to give up their lives based off of this call. This calling is going to end their earthly lives, and he's praying for them. And I believe that he's looking at them with the most love that anyone can look, and he's asking the Father, "Are you sure these are the men?" And God says, "Yes, these are the men. Now go." Jesus rises out of his green pasture and he walks along the still water and he calls out these men who he's going to build his church upon, and he restores their soul as they get to follow the Son of the living God. And he calls them out, and they might not know. They're confused. There's many times in the Gospels that they simply don't get it, and it's frustrating. And you know Jesus had been frustrated, but they're walking every day in obedience, doing the best that they know how, and they spent one-on-one time with the Messiah. And he slowly began to reveal himself more and more and more until one day an epiphany hit them. As they were sitting to themselves quiet in a room, the Spirit came upon them and they suddenly got it. They understood that the hope and the peace and the love comes from the Lord only, that Jesus is the Son of God, and that what he said was true, and that he did raise from the grave. He conquered sin and death, and he's called them out. He's revealed himself over 3 years span. and he encouraged them, and they were entering into the most hostile valley of the shadow of death, but they had more peace and tranquility than ever before, for they finally got it. The Lord is our shepherd. We lack nothing with the Spirit of God inside of us. We lack nothing. We are who he says he is. We're covered by the blood. When God sees us, he sees his Son. And he lies us down in green pastures, giving us the rest that we need. And he guides us along the still waters, and he restores our soul daily. What does our alone time look like? Is it a time of restoration, or are we still in a point of stress? He guides us on the right path, revealing himself one faithful step at a time. And even though we know we're walking into a valley, we have no idea what it's going to look like planting this church down the road, but we are actually going into a valley. That is where Phoenix is, and we know it's going to be tough, but we know this for sure, that God is with us. He's with us, and he's protecting us. He even goes as far as to give us a place to eat. He prepares a table in the presence of people who are hostile to the gospel, in the presence of people who seek to destroy us. He prepares a table, and he anoints us. And as a follower of Christ, I am an anointed man. My wife is an anointed woman, and you are anointed if Jesus Christ is the Savior of your life. And when you're anointed, that is enough. And he overflows us with his blessing and his presence, but we have to be present for that present in order to overflow that out into our world. And so he overflows us with who he is and his goodness, and it might be tough, and if we're still in a valley, God is still good, and he's overflowing from us. And we know this, that we will always dwell in the house of the Lord, and that his goodness and his love will follow us no matter which step. As long as we're faithful, he is there. And when we're not, he's picking us up, and he's there. The still waters of the soul are not just a moment in time, but it's a state of being. And while there's external circumstances and darkness around us, when the soul is at peace and when you're good with God and when you get alone with him and you know his will, he will have you covered and you will know your call. So you ask, how do we know what our call is? I want to ask you, how is your soul? Have you created that space in your life to get alone with the Father? It's hard at first, I'm telling you. To get alone with the Father. And I know that you think that alone time as a pastor, I'm sitting there mounting turkey saying, God, bless thine hands as I bring about the birdeth of creation and guideth my plaque that I am carving out to honor you. And that's not necessarily how it was. Instead, I was just sitting there. And when we get alone, we begin to self-reflect and we get to know ourselves. And when we know ourselves, we know who God has created, and we get to know God a little bit better, and he brings himself to light. So maybe you need to just get alone, and you have permission today. Tell your husband, tell your wife, tell your kids. It's incredible. Create that space in your life. That doesn't mean you're lazy or selfish. It just means you're doing the way that you were divinely designed to be. Get alone with God and get to know him. You get to know him, I promise you, you'll hear your call. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for who you are. God, I pray that you test us and you stress us, God. That you also restore us and give us rest. So, God, when we're in the valleys, we can rest assured that our soul is at peace, walking along the still waters of who you are. I know there's many of us in troubled times. God, we don't know how to deal. I pray that the peace of your presence will comfort us, and that you will be enough, God, that we can sacrifice our alone time and give it to you, so that when we're alone, it's your alone time with us. God, we thank you. We pray this in your holy, beautiful, and peaceful name. Amen.